Hello guys, I am continuing the presentation of the overclock tweaker menu of the ASRock Z370 Extreme 4 motherboard paired with an Intel Core i5-8600K. In my previous video I showed you my settings for 5 GHz. Now I will just... I have some more things to say regarding the overclocking menu of this motherboard. And this needed to be a separate video in order to not make things too long for the overclocking 5 GHz video. I cannot stress this enough, be very cautious of the positioning of your memory DIMMs. You need to go on the DDR4A2 and DDR4B2 slots. These are the primary slots of the system, not the A1, B1. This has been the case for quite some time now, but I missed that due to having to upgrade my system for quite some time. In any case, keep this in mind if you decide to go to a newer system and your system is quite old, you probably will have missed this information. It is mentioned in the manual, of course, but who reads manuals, right? So, in the OC tweaker menu, you have two strings that will show you what clocks you will be getting from your selections. Everything you will be changing will be shown here, in terms of clocks, that is. But there are many other settings aside from clocks that are very important for a stable and cool overclocking setting. So, the CPU configuration first. If this is set to auto and this is set to auto, the system will be running essentially at stock. And this at auto and this at auto. Now we are looking at stock settings, and this is what you will be presented with once you power on the system for the first time. The multi-core enhancement is a controversial setting that is available in most Z370 motherboards, if not all of them. What this does is that it sets the all-core turbo boost clock at a higher setting than what normally would be available. For example, if this multi-core enhancement is disabled, you will only be getting the max turbo clock of the one core, which is 4.3 GHz. The all core turbo boost will be 4.1 GHz. But if this will be at enabled, you will be getting 4.3 GHz for all cores, all core boost and sustained boost, that is. So essentially your CPU will be running at 4.3 GHz. This is a slight overclock of the CPU. This had been controversial because you gain 200 MHz above the all core boost, which gives a slight performance advantage for the Coffee Lake CPUs compared to the competition, which are now the Ryzen CPUs from AMD, the very good Ryzen CPUs. Personally, this is my choice of preference. I use the system at stock settings with multi-core enhancement, and it is very fast. I only overclock 5 GHz for benchmarks, to tell you the truth. Coffee Lake at 6 core Coffee Lake CPU is plenty fast for my needs, to tell you the truth. I cannot speak for you guys, of course. You can do whatever you want for your system. In any case, if you start overclocking other than using the multi-core enhancement, if you set the CPU core ratio to something else, as you can see, there are some options here. You can set specific per core clock, for example. Okay, you can set the per core CPU core limits, which is a quite interesting method to overclock your system. For example, you can use a mix of both stock settings and overclock settings. With this one, you can set the 6 cores ratio limit, means that when all 6 cores are loaded, the ratio that will be sustained is the 41, which means 4.1 GHz of CPU clock. Then if only 5 if only 5 cores are in operation, we will be getting again 4.1 GHz. However, if you have only one core ratio of only one core in operation, its clock speed will be able to jump to 4.3 GHz. What you see here are, of course, basically the stock settings of how the Coffee Lake 8600K is operating. If you start fiddling around with that, for example, you can set this to 43. Yes, you must start with the one core ratio, of course. You can set this to 45, you can set this to 44, you can set this to 43, and all the rest at 43, for example, which will essentially do what? If up to 4 cores, we have 6, 5, 4 and 3 cores at 43, meaning that everything above 2 core operation will result in 4.3 GHz, but you will have the benefit of a 2 core ratio of 4.4 GHz, and for the single boost will be at 4.5 GHz. There is a vast variety of what you can do with the per core CPU ratio. As you understand, you can set this even to 50. Yes, I messed up, sorry. In any case, there is a vast variety of what you can do with the per core settings. You can set this, for example, like I just did, 4 GHz max 6 core ratio limit, but you will have the advantage of a 5 GHz possible boost on a single core ratio limit, which will give you a significant boost in single threaded applications if you use something like that. Of course, the problem with all that is that current operating systems are multi-threaded, and they will of course have some load on all cores whatever you do, so it will be quite difficult to reach 5 GHz boost with these settings. But it will not be out of the question. That is the point of all these settings. With experimentation of the workloads you need, you will find the best settings for this specific per core CPU ratio. Of course, the preferable option to overclock is the all core ratio, which you will be absolutely sure that all cores will be running at your requested speed. For 5 GHz, for example, as I showed you on my 5 GHz settings video, you can set this to 50, and you will have 5 GHz for all cores, no matter what, when they are loaded. But this also increases a lot the power requirements of the system. Then we have the CPU cache ratio, which can go up to 50, up to the CPU clock ratio to be exact. For example, you can set it to 50, but not 51. Oh, it goes to 51, my bad. But the description suggests that it should not go above 50. Personally, I keep it to 45. There are many options that can be fiddled, can be tweaked, but personally I do not see the reason to tamper with them. For example, one setting that you should definitely leave alone is the BCLK frequency. It has been known for a long time since the Sandy Bridge CPUs that if this setting goes above 100 MHz, stability issues start to appear very quickly, even by 3 MHz above the 100 MHz threshold, it starts to give problems to the user. There is no reason to fiddle around with this setting, since you have an unlocked processor. At least I hope you have an unlocked processor. Then we have the spread spectrum, which should be kept disabled if you are overclocking. The boot performance mode is an interesting setting that essentially says to the operating system to not go to the motherboard, basically to not go to the max clock setting until the operating system is loaded. And you can see that it says that this option is suggested for BCLK overclocking mostly, but I have set it at like that, no problem so far. Reliability stress restrictor, I'm not sure what this does. There are many options here. FCLK frequency. Yes, this is again for BCLK overclocking. I'm not interested in that, to tell you the truth. The AVX ratio offset is very important, because if you tweak that, every setting you will input, for example, if you set the AVX ratio of 5, when the CPU will meet AVX instructions, it will drop from 5 GHz, which I have set now, to 4.5 GHz. So this offset essentially says a number which 100 will be multiplied. It is 5 times 100, meaning 500 megahertz lower than the max allowed CPU clock speed. I have seen that the 860-100K is very stable even with AVX instructions. And since hyperthreading is missing, the temperature is also very good, so I keep this at auto. So the CPU will be at 5 GHz all the time. Believe it or not, I had done a run with Grand Theft Auto 4, the older Grand Theft Auto, and it was dropping its clocks. The CPU was dropping its clocks at 4.5 GHz. Even in Grand Theft Auto 4, so I left that at auto, and 5 GHz was sustainable at all times. And you have seen that in all my videos, the CPU runs at 5 GHz, no problem whatsoever. There are some other settings here. There is a ring to core ratio offset. You see the description. I do not touch that. I want also the speed step technology to be enabled. The turbo boost, I'm not sure if it will be working, because I have 5 GHz already. I have gone above the turbo boost already, so it does not really make any significance when you are overclocking. However, it will be significant if you are using stock clock. The CPU will not be able to go above the base clock, which is very low, 3.6 GHz. So leave this at enabled. And of course, the long duration power limits and the short duration power limits and the long duration maintained are some important settings that will affect how the CPU will work in different stress levels. For example, if you set these values to low, the CPU will not be able to convincingly run at the requested clocks. These are watt numbers you are typing in here. So probably you can go as high as you want. Even you can set this to at 200, this is essentially limits, not that the CPU will go to 200 watts. From what I have seen, the Core i5-8600K does not even go above 100 at 5 GHz with the Intel Power Gadget. So I think 120 for the long duration, 150 for the long duration, 120 for the long duration and 120 for the 150 for the short are enough for me, and they get the job done, no problem whatsoever. There is also the long duration here maintained. I leave it at auto because I think the system knows what to do. You can set this to from a value of 1 to up to a value of 128. It does not matter, I believe. You can probably put in the maximum allowed value, so you can be sure that the long duration is really long, but auto also gets the job done. Now this all have to do with the clocks of the system. Of course, other than the clocks, we have the voltage configuration. The voltage configuration is very important for stability of the system. There are two settings, as you can see, three basically, but for overclocking, the offset and the fixed mode are what you should select. Basically, I prefer the offset voltage mode, as I showed you in my 5 GHz overclocking video. But you can also set the fixed mode if it feels better for you. I want the offset because I want the CPU to go up and down in voltage depending on the load, so it can be both cool in low load and okay, stable at high load. There are 5 levels of CPU load line calibration. Auto is basically for stock clocks. Maybe it is clever enough, so when you overclock and you have auto CPU load line calibration, it will go to the proper level of 5. Level 1 is for overclocking, level 5 is for stock clock. There are of course intermediate settings which you can test. Basically for me, I set level 1 for overclocking just to be sure, and it is absolutely stable from my test. The system has not crashed, not even once in my gaming tests, with an offset voltage of 50 millivolts. You can see that these are millivolts we are inputting here. They may be very little, but they need caution nonetheless. Millivolts are very small units, but they need caution. If you run at 5 GHz, heat and power draw can go up very fast if you use wrong settings. My DRAM voltage was 1.35. I have set it to 1.36 because I have tampered with the timings of my RAM. I have set them to lower settings, and it needed just a little voltage in order to be a little more stable. I do not touch the rest of the voltages, to tell you the truth. I find no reason to do so, at least for 5 GHz. Maybe for higher clock speeds they could help a little, I think. But basically these are probably better left alone. The memory controller PLL voltage, yes, why touch the memory controller voltage? I'm not sure. You can test all these settings, however, to see if anything works better for you. For me, I leave them as they are. And of course, there is the DRAM tweaker under the OC tweaker menu. also very important. The first thing you will need to do, of course, is to load the XMP setting of your RAM. I'm using DDR4 3200 speed for my memory sticks. I mean, this is what they support, this is not what I use. However, my as you can see in the XMP2 profile one here, my RAM sticks are running at 15-15-15-35 timings at 1.35 volts. What I have done is tweak the cache latency and the RAS to cache delay, so everything will be running at 14 nanoseconds timings and not 15. The tighter the timings, the better it is for a more speedy system, of course. And from, of course, you are messing up with the stability of your system if you tweak these settings. But luckily for me, my RAM sticks are Samsung B dies, and they are quite capable at handling the lower timings with just 1.36 volts. There are many options you can touch and tweak in the timings sub settings, and you are on a fast track to make the system unstable. I do not touch all these settings, my friends. I only tweaked I only tweaked the primary sub timings of the memory, and it is quite fast and stable as it is right now, so I have really no need to touch anything else. Now, there is a DRAM tweaker, as you can see, which you can on which you can change the settings. XMP1, you can also change the voltage, etc. So this is probably a little advanced for most people, and I would advise you to not really mess up with all these things. But there is an option to mess up with these things. That's what I'm trying to tell you. If you need to test your luck or your abilities, this is the place to go for DRAM tweaking. And basically that's it, my friends. That's all I have to say about the OC tweaker. Many settings, as you may have understood by now. Few settings are really needed to be tweaked in order to reach 5 GHz, and probably higher settings as well, higher clocks as well. However, this motherboard is quite capable of exposing all available options for the Coffee Lake CPU, and that's the point of this video. You can do many things. It is a very decent motherboard, very reasonably priced as well, so that's why it was the motherboard of choice for me. Thank you very much for watching, my friends. I hope this video will help some people. Stay tuned for more tutorials and benchmarking fun as well. Take care.